Hi, I'm Toby and welcome back to The Joy of Mathematics. I'm so glad you could join me today. I'll run some ideas across the bottom of the screen that we are going to encounter during a story today. I'd also like to thank this episode's sponsor, brilliant.org. So today's story is another one about our friend Bob. You may remember Bob from a previous episode. He lives in a little hut in the hills and he cares very deeply about his animal friends. So this story starts early in the morning when Bob is in fact asleep. He is awoken though by the sound of an acorn hitting his little tin roof. You see, Bob's hut is surrounded by several tall oak trees. The frequency of the acorns falling on his roof is getting less and less as the days get colder and autumn comes to an end. But Bob walks outside and collects the acorn that woke him, as well as a few other acorns, and he puts them in his basket of acorns, which he has been collecting. These baskets are overflowing, so Bob knows that it is time for his yearly acorn adventure. Bob doesn't have much use for the acorns, but knows of a large family of squirrels who need them to snack on during winter's hibernation. It is time to take the acorns to the squirrels. The only problem is, there's a giant lake in the way. Bob does have a small rowboat, which he's going to use to take the acorns across the lake. It took him several trips back and forth to load the baskets of acorns into his boat. And as he was doing so, he noticed a sign. It was a warning sign. And Bob will need to understand the sign to know whether it's safe to go out on the lake today. Bob looks out onto the water and he can see a duck out here. It is bobbing up and down smoothly with the water. This motion is actually the same motion that Bob moved with when he was loading the acorns into the boat. He was jogging backwards and forwards between the boat and the acorns, jogging fastest in the middle section, but slowing down to pick up a basket or slowing down when he reached the boat as well. If he didn't, he would trip over it. Smoothly going back and forwards is what is meant by sine. It's a natural sway, the epitome of smoothness. A gentle back and forth rocking that starts fast, slows down, turns around, and speeds up again. It is the way that a spring would bounce or a pendulum would swing. A different way to move backwards and forwards would be abruptly, like something that bounces off a wall at full speed without slowing down. That would not move in the motion of sine. If we traced the path of the duck over time, it would trace out a sine wave. It's the same smooth motion of sine, but with a horizontal component. The warning sign was there to say that a sine-shaped wave was moving through the water, and that was what was causing the duck to bob up and down. This is a sine wave that I've drawn in terms of its width and height, but it also moves forward in time because the wind is blowing it to the right. I can only draw a snapshot of the wave. This is a picture taken at t equals zero, the time at midnight, but it is always moving. How high and how low the wave gets depends on the first number on the sine here. This is the wave's amplitude. For this wave, it is 4, so the wave will get up to 4 meters high and 4 meters low. That's kind of lucky because the dangerous sea creatures lurk at about 6 meters in depth, so Bob's not going to encounter them on the boat today. If there was no number here, it would be our stock standard sine wave, and it would get up to 1 meter high and minus 1 meters low down the bottom. The second number on the sine is inside the bracket, it's in front of the X, and it has to do with how stretched out or squashed the wave is. If there was no number here, then the wave would reset after its natural cycle. That would be how far the wave travels before it gets back to where it started, which was zero. I'll make it a little bit clearer here that the wave starts at zero, goes up, gets to zero, goes down, and gets back to zero. So to about here is one cycle. But what is the natural cycle of sine? Well, it might be helpful to think about a circle. Now, circles are often used to explain sine, but a circle is really nothing more than combining two sine waves, one in the horizontal direction and one in the vertical direction, offset by a quarter of a cycle, and you could call that cosine. To complete one cycle of a circle, you would have to go around 360 degrees. And that is the natural cycle of sine too. But we don't have to work in degrees. Those are just a human construct. If we think about a standard sine that goes from 1 to -1, that would trace out a circle of radius 1. Now we can define a radian as the distance traveled around a circle divided by the radius of that circle. So in one full cycle of sine, we will go all the way around the circle. Always when you want to find out the circumference of a circle, it will be twice the radius times pi. So for us, we will have twice the radius, that's 2, times pi. Divide that by our radius, which is 1, and we could just as well have written that as 2 pi. 2 pi is the number of radians in our circle, a different way of writing 360 degrees. 2 pi is the natural cycle of sine. It's how far we would need to travel in the x direction before the wave gets back to where it started. Now, all that is true unless we have a number here in front of the x. Then we're either going to be squished or a little stretched out. The secret lies in the number that we have here on the bottom. For us, it is a 5. We have 2 pi over 5. And 5 is actually our wavelength. It tells us that for our wave, it takes a distance in the x direction of 5 meters before it gets back where it started. Now that's not 2 pi. If it had have been our natural 2 pi for our standard sine wave, then we would have had a 2 pi on the bottom there, and the 2 pi on the top and bottom would have cancelled to leave us with nothing written there. Essentially a 1 in front of our x. But we have a 2 pi over 5, so we know that this entire distance will be 5, meaning that each bump or each trough is going to be 2.5 meters across. That's kind of useful information to try and figure out if it's safe for our little boat, which is 2 meters long, to travel along it. And I think a 2 meter long boat on a 2.5 meter bump, that's okay, that should be all right for Bob. So now we know things about the size of the wave, but how fast is the whole thing moving across? Well, we can look to the last term in our equation here to find that out. If we added any number in here inside the brackets, it would shift the wave along. But a wave on the water doesn't just shift a bit and then stop. It continues moving. So that's why we have multiplied a number in here by t. This offset will continue to grow as time goes on. Now, in a very similar fashion to what we did with our first term, we can look at the number on the bottom of this 2 pi fraction here to find out how long it will take our wave to essentially reset. This time it's not resetting in space, but in time. For us, it would take 10 seconds for our wave to move, such that it's moved along and it looks like it is where it started. So this swell would move over to here and a different swell would replace it. That 10 seconds is the period of our wave. For us, it takes 10 seconds to move a distance of 5 meters, since that was our wavelength, giving us the speed of our wave as 0.5 meters per second. Note that there is a negative sign in here for this term, which does move the wave to the right, and a positive sign in there would have moved it over to the left. A wave speed of 0.5 meter a second is actually pretty good for Bob. It will help him get to the other side of the lake pretty quickly. The thing with Bob is that everything in his life tends to work out to be just right, almost suspiciously convenient. And since today is no different, Bob sets off across the lake, smiling at the sign, knowing that even though it will be a little bumpy, he's going to have a joyous journey. He enjoys every high swell and laughs on the way down. It was a very sunny day, and as Bob stepped off his boat on the other side of the lake, he noticed he had developed a bit of a tan. He delivered the acorns to the squirrels, who were very thankful. Bob knew he had given much more than they needed, but if they lost some or couldn't eat all of the ones that they buried, the acorns would grow into oak trees and help to provide food for the future generations. It is now time to thank our sponsor and to deliver a special message. If you enjoyed learning something today, you may want to try Brilliant. Brilliant is a problem-solving based website and app with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, and interesting problems to solve. They have a course that covers trigonometry, and the interactive quizzes explore more about sine, cosine, tan, and how these concepts relate to things like triangles and circles. You can sign up for free at brilliant.org/tibbies, and the first 200 of my viewers who subscribe to Brilliant Premium will get 20% off. Thank you to Brilliant. This is Bob. Bob collects acorns. Bob cares for the squirrels. Bob is a good guy. Be like Bob. Bob's actions, as well as helping the squirrels, will help to plant new trees. Bob is part of Team Trees and encourages you to also plant some trees or donate to the Arbor Day Foundation at teamtrees.org to help plant 20 million happy little trees by 2020. I'd like to wish you happy studying, and I hope that you have an absolutely mathematical day.